here at the Dances with Words CD release party and concert. And oop, gotta get the videos back again. There we are. Oh, we've got a number of people on it already. And I know it takes a few seconds for the feed to get through. And boy, we were just, see, the thing is, folks, we were telling jokes. So already we're behind because Rich and I were telling jokes back and forth, which never happens when we get together. But it does. It does tonight. And I'm going to put the chat on so and give people a chance to sign on and get all logged in there. And please do say hi as you get on. And what do you say, Rich? Let's start with a song here. From Alpha to Omega, you can bet the alphabet. Like a painting done by Degas, will leap and pirouette. It's stupendous, tremendous, and over-endous. Dances with words. We're dancing with words, prancing with words, enhancing, entrancing, advancing with words. It's dances with words. You go.
Ooh, women, we're doing both of us, that's right. Okay, so here we go. Thank you, Hugo, who, my God.
I'm highly rehearsed
and wordaholic, logoreic and eclectic. Lexically, I'm apoplectic, logophile and logoleptic. We're dancing with words, prancing with words, enhancing, entrancing, advancing with words. It's dances with words.
It's glorious, uproarious, notorious, victorious, outrageous, courageous, contagious, and verbivorous. Dances with words. It's stupendous, tremendous, end over endless. Dances with words. We're dancing with words, prancing with words, enhancing, entrancing, advancing with words. It's dances with words. It's dances with words. Welcome, everybody, to the Dances with Words CD release concert, coming to you tonight with author, bestselling author Richard Lederer and myself, Bill Shipper, right from two locations. And as it's two locations and online, we're going to do our best to make it technically work, to tell you according our concert, and we're going to sing from that. We're going to sing some live, and we're going to try to be as live as we can. And it's all about music and words, right, Rich?
It sure is, and of course, this is why we can't sing together, because of the electronic distance, but on the track, and ordinarily, we would be singing together, but we can't do it here, so we're doing the best we can, but I will tell you, on this little baby, we are singing together with all sorts of instrumentation, and having fun winging it here. Good to see so many people checking in.
And want to say hi here. Hi, Mike. Hi, Beth. Brain Car. I like that. And James, hi. And Gene, thank you for saying more volume. I'll adjust that. And let me know your feedback as we get on here. Through. Hey, Freya, good to see you. And Charles. And Eileen.
Yes.
Charles, Eileen Patton. Hi, guys. All right. Do you want to...
Oh, boy. That's great.
Yeah. So I'm going to show the my screen here, and I'm going to talk about the CD just for a quick minute, and then we're going to get to some music and some talking about words. And like we said, we're highly rehearsed technical cue to cue here, doing our best to get it. We have a CD, a recording that... that we've made together with a program that we've been working and Rich and I have been working on this for a number of years through a partnership, and we have recorded it through the pandemic in parts and different recording sessions, and have put it together for you, and we'll be telling you more about it as we go. And tell us about music and words, language, Rich.
Sure, Will. Well, music is an important language is metaphor, and Bill and I never metaphor we didn't like. And because music is so important to it, and what you're going to be hearing tonight and listening to on the CD, perhaps, would be essentially my lyrics, essentially, and Bill's music. And it just has been 1 + 1 = infinity. And we've been taking it around to a number of places, but this is our bouncing baby CD because it is just born into the world. So time to face the music, and that's a metaphor when an actor of whatever gender goes out in front of the curtain and has the music comes up and there's that little bit of stage fright and you face the music. We hope to pull out all the stops and not soft pedal any ideas about dances with words. And notice both of those are in our vocabulary, but started with music. I am often a keynote speaker, and that comes from a cappella, not Acapulco, a cappella singers, and the leader strikes the proper key and the proper note, hence keynote. And I'm not going to give you a second string performance, which we now think of as athletic, but it was actually the backup strings in case the first strings broke, you would have the second strings, and they were just as valuable as the first. So the meaning has changed. And that's how we got the idea of dances with words. We dance with words all the time, and especially music.
And one of the songs that I'm really crazy about is about crazy English. Why is English crazy?
Well, we are the most widely spoken language on earth, but we're crazy because we're very playful. So you can drive in a parkway. Park in a driveway, play at a recital and recite at a play. A man gets a hernia, a woman a hysterectomy. Your nose can run and your feet can smell. And that's what the song is about. All those vagaries, if pro and con are opposite, it's Congress, the opposite of progress. Set in this case to the music of Kathy Lowe, a much earlier partner I had with a concert.
Yes. All right. I'm crazy about the way this came through. So here you are. I'm going to play it and give me a thumbs up if it's, if the audio is coming through okay or too loud or too little. And let's go hear Crazy English.
There's music in the language.
Music in the language.
Rhythm in the music.
Rhythm in the music.
Listen to the music in the words we say.
Listen to the music in the words we say.
Listen to the rhythm of the words at play.
Listen to the rhythm of the words at play.
How is it possible to drive in a parkway?
Park in the driveway.
Play at a recital.
Recite at a play.
A man has a hernia.
A woman a hysterectomy.
Your nose can run.
And your feet can smell.
Crazy English. Crazy English. Language for the verbally insane. Insane.
Language for the verbally insane.
There's music in the language.
Music in the language.
Rhythm in the music.
Rhythm in the music.
Listen to the music in the words we say.
Listen to the music in the words we say.
Listen to the rhythm of the words at play.
Listen to the rhythm of the words at play.
How is it possible a writer writes?
And a speaker speaks.
A baker bakes.
And a hunter hunts.
But grocers don't gross.
And ushers don't ush.
And haberdashers do not haberdash. Crazy English. Crazy English. Language for the verbally insane. Insane.
Language for the verbally insane.
How is it possible there's no straw in strawberry?
No pine in pineapple.
No peas in peanuts.
No egg in eggplant.
No mo in mohair.
No word in wormwood.
No sand in sandwich.
No ham in hamburger.
Crazy English. Crazy English. Language for the verbally insane. Insane.
Language for the verbally insane.
Beauty
the music in the language.
Rhythm in the music.
Rhythm in the music.
Listen to the music in the words we say.
Listen to the music in the words we say.
Listen to the rhythm of the words at play.
Listen to the rhythm of the words at play.
Language for the verbally insane.
Gotta get that last tangent play in there. Yeah,
Bill, I love the slide whistle there. And how many instruments do we have on the CD? Totally,
that, that's a good question.
I think about six.
The answer is right here on the back of this, and it's probably, yeah, six or seven or eight there. We have piano on right. A nice piano on one of them, the trombone on that one. So it's really, I'm an excellent engineer who put this together, Jacob Church there, the local Memphis boy. So I like that. Not only is there no ham and hamburger, but I think there was no ham on the lyric list too. So whoever did that lyric list, I got to get back to that guy and have him redo that. I think I missed something there. But the lyrics are all here on the CD, which makes it a wonderful little booklet, really. And everything, all the lyrics are there and proofread by our proofreaders and grammatically correct, because grammar is important. And why is grammar important?
Well, if you ain't going to be speaking no good grammar with me, I ain't going to be. And this irregardless of what you say. I happen to have the honor of having been usage editor for the Random House Dictionary of the English Language Usage Editor. And people get, you know, kind of concerned about language. For example, I would ask all of you out there, which is correct, 9 and 7 is 15 or 9 and 7 are 15?
Put your answers in the chat.
The answer is in the chat. It is okay. And the answer is, of course, it's 16. But if you happen to fall into that linguistic trap, it's probably because you're a little worried about, grammar and so on. And if you have a grammar question, and any of you who know Away With Words, the radio show that I co-hosted at its birth, I love answering questions about language and all of that.
And we got our chat back. Nobody fell for it, Rich.
Nobody did, darn.
Nobody fell for it.
Well, that's good, because they are psychically mobile, William. You know, that's great.
I think so. All right. Hey, Ken's on there too. Hi, Jennifer and Ken. And hey, everybody. And if you're sneaking on and haven't said hello yet, please do say hello in the chat. So, a verb, a noun, and an adjective walk into a bar. Then it got tense. Right. That wasn't all tenses there. We do it right in the song, though. But this is a song I'm going to do live now, but it is on the album. But I'm going to do live because I like to play, and I think it'll come. Hey, Irene. All right, we got some more people coming on.
Irene.
Now, this is a song that we borrow the melody, as you'll hear. I hope you enjoy. And like I said, we are highly, highly coordinated and rehearsed. We know exactly what's happening next. Okay, as we adjust the old-fashioned paper. It's 9 o'clock in the language bar. The parts of speech shuffle in. There's an old simile sitting next to me, cool as a tall glass of gin. He says, son, I've got a preposition for you. I hope that you don't take offense. Then the past, present, and future walked in. That's when it got tense. La da 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 da. La da 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 da. Sing us a song, you're the grammar man. Sing us a song tonight. Well, we're all in the mood for an English class, and you've got to teach us to write, write. Mrs. Malaprop sits in the corner, casting dispersions on the joint. Like a wolf in cheap clothing, she's taken for granted. But hey, that's a mute point. The subjunctive wishes he were in the bar, steeped in the mood of regret. A participle in infinitive, chill in the corner, drinking to forget. Beneath, beside, beyond, under, round, among, near, according to. A misplaced modifier is trading jokes with a man with an earring named Bart. Three intransitive verbs walk into the bar. They sit, they converse, they depart. This insane hyperbole tears into the bar, totally ripping apart everything within reach. An adverb and pronoun give him quickly calm down. I literally died, said a figure of speech. Present imperfect, blue perfect, future preterite, future perfect. Sing us a song, you're the grammar man. Sing us a song tonight. Well, we're all in the mood for an English class, and you've got to teach us to write, write. An old cliché staggers into the bar on this dark and stormy night. The bartender scowls at a font, Comic Sans, shouting, "Hey, we don't serve your type." And the rogue verb swaggers into the bar, throws an elegant noun, his best lines. Spurred on by libation, he suggests conjugation, in which case the noun declines. Nominative, genitive, dative, accusative, ablative, evocative. Sing us a song, you're the grammar man. Sing us a song tonight. Well, we're all in the mood for an English class, and you've got to teach us to write. Right, bum 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 bum.
Bill, I'm just so pleased with the number of folks in our audience, and I said number, not amount, because number is countable. And you notice in this song that it's all self-referential. So subjunctive mood, condition contrary to fact. If I were you, I can't be you. Maybe I'd like to be you, but I can't. And there it is in the actual lyrics and the cliche. And you see from, incidentally, 18th century French printing, along with stereotype and the simile and all of that, prepositions, just brilliantly woven in by Bill. And that's the thing about, this is learning dressed up to have fun, my friends. This CD is classic dulce et utile, sweet and instructive. And this was really a lot of fun for us. And we actually sing together on the track, but not on this one.
Yeah, thanks, Rich. And speaking about the CD here, this is an example of how the words are there. And we try to put the whole of the lyrics in. Well, it's a little small, but it is readable and accurate there. So it's you could sing along to it. And you can order. And actually, we're going to talk about a couple specials here. One is $20. The CD price is $20, but tonight, if you buy it, I'm going to send you another CD. You just pick out whether you want My Lover Loves Liver or There's a Spider in the Corner as a bonus CD to go along with it. And we're going to have a package special later on, too. But some people say, well, I don't have a CD player or whatever. I don't want to buy CDs. But here is our 10 reasons why you should buy this CD. Are you ready? The countdown here. Number one, the music's great, right? You just heard that. Number two, It's also a book. You're getting a book of the works that we've done together. Three, it's a collectible in two collections because it's adding to the collection of your Bill Shipper collection and your Rich Lederer collection. I know a lot of you out there do have a lot of both of them. And four, buying CDs supports the artists. It's you'll learn a lot about language. Number five, probably the most important one here after the music, of course, right, Rich? Yeah,
yes.
After music there, and then I'll autograph it for you. Number six, number seven, not going to be on streaming services. This is just in a CD package. Eight, CDs make great gifts, and everybody gives gifts for Thanksgiving, right? And then Christmas and Hanukkah are coming up after there, and nine, CDs are coming back. And 10, it is the only published work with both Richard Lederer and Bill Shipper on there.
And it's really brand new. We're not kidding. This has just come out. Not that newness matters with us. These are universal elements, but it does happen to be new. So the timing is great. So shall we do some calling on the homophone, Bill?
Yes. Hello?
Hello, yes. Okay, so a homophone, as you can see from the word parts, classical word parts, homo same, phone sound. So these are two words that sound the same but have different meanings. And when I was very young and dinosaurs roamed the earth, the first kind of wordplay that I can remember is what's black and white and red all over. And some of you will remember the one, the primordial one, the archetypal answer is a newspaper, black and white, and red, R-E-A-D and R-E-D. So it's what could be also red? Oh, it's R-E-A-D, a newspaper. You read a newspaper, that odd verb red. I think the only one in our language spelled the same but pronounced differently, present and past. What do you call a naked grizzly? So the same sound but different spelling. I hope I got that right the first time. A pony with a sore throat. A horse. Notice different spelling, same sound, different meanings. And have you heard about the successful perfume manufacturer? Her business made a lot of sense. So okay, perfume, S-C-E-N-T-S. Okay. It was successful, C-E-N-T-S, and it was just and appropriate that she have that business, S-E-N-S-E. So there are three packed into one, and that's essentially what a pun is. This much meaning packed into this much space, compacted, in an effort to be humorous. I say that because sometimes we don't laugh at them, but the idea is that they're funny. So here is one of our earlier songs, Bill, Calling on the Homophone.
Yes. Here we are.
And listen to the marvelous melody here.
I'll share this with the melody and the lyrics there.
Here's a wry piece we made up. In our idle time, we wrote it for you to see how homophones can seem so wild, from their nose right to their toes. With pride we know it will not bore you, it's meant to be read aloud.
One night, a knight on a horse rode out upon a road. This man wore mail for war and would explore a wood that glowed. His tale will tell from head to tail, will write his right upright. A hidden sight our hero found, a sight that we shall cite.
Here's a wry piece we made up in our idle time. We wrote it for you to see how homophones can seem so wild, from their nose right to their toes. with pride. We know it will not bore you. It's meant to be read aloud.
With woe, he shouted, woe, as rain without a break did rain. To break, he pulled the rein, and like a shattered pane felt pain. The poor knight met a witch, which made sweat pour from every pore. He'd never seen a scene like that, his sore heart couldn't soar.
Here's a rhyme piece we made up in our idle time. We wrote it for you to see how homophobes can seem so wild, from their nose right to their toes. With pride we know it will not bore you. It's meant to be read aloud.
The bell has tolled, we're told, the hour to end our tale draws nigh. Without ado, we bid adieu, so bye or leave, bye-bye.
Here's a wry piece we made up in our idle time. We wrote it for you to see how homophobes can seem so wild, from their nose right to their toes. With pride we know it will not bore you. It's meant to be read aloud.
And friends, we really feel that there's nothing else in the universe like this combination. Bill Shipper, so gifted musically. I, who have Van Gogh's ear for music, nonetheless have hopped on the bandwagon to do another music thing. So you'll notice there my lyrics, what happens is it looks like gibberish, but it actually, when you hear it, it sounds like regular English, and that's the fun in playing off the homophones. I think my favorite part of that, since I wrote the lyrics, the poor knight met a witch, which made pet sweat pour from every pore. That's three spellings of pores, three meanings, and yet the sentence flows like regular English.
Excellent.
It was a wonderful challenge.
And that was Kathy Lowe's music on that. So that's that was the title of her.
My New Hampshire partner, when I was out teaching in an Episcopal boarding school in New Hampshire for only three decades or close to it.
I want to catch up. Rich, if you don't mind, before we get into this, I want to catch up some comments, because I think Mike was talking about back on the Grammar Man song, Paul the Real Estate Obelisk, on that misheard lyric from what they call a mondegreem, or a misheard lyric.
Yeah, mondegreem.
Egghorn sometimes. Yes.
Egghorn. Right. And if anyone needs examples of any of this stuff, email me and perhaps Bill, and I'll send you what you want. Gee, there was a malapropism in Grammar Man. Boy, have I written about Mrs. Malaprop, Richard Brinsley Sheridan's 1775 play, The Rivals, and that's when that woman was born.
And hey to Steve Mason, and actually William Gay, I think, backing up a little bit more, we didn't say hi to William and to Melanie. Thanks for coming on, everybody. And Ken Schwartz, there's commenting that some newspapers, since they have colored photos, they're not black and white and red all over. They're color too.
Right.
Being a little,
well, it used to be one of the answers, Bill, was Pravda, because that was the newspaper of Russia, but now it doesn't work anymore. So literally red all over. That was
right. Right. And that's not the same as the devil wears Pravda. What that is.
Yeah, right.
It's a little different.
But hey, you're pretty good at that stuff. Yeah.
All right. Sven, anybody else, say hello. Just pop your comments in there and in questions, because we're going to have this interactive as we go. We want to be able to talk to you about things. And in the meantime, what the heck is a heteronym?
Okay, a heteronym. So a homophone would be two words spelled differently that sound the same. But a heteronym is the opposite. It's two words spelled the same but sound different. So as this song you'll hear it. Please come through the entrance of, well, I can't do it without the music. Please come through the entrance of this little poem. I guarantee it will entrance you. Well, entrance and entrance look the same. They sound different. And it's a complete accident. So things like primer and primer are both from the same root. They're really the same word. Convert and convert, noun, verb, convict, convict, they are not heteronyms. But what you're going to hear and see here are two words that by accident sound the same, but they are completely unrelated. So you see there on heteronyms and a lovely tune here. And so there you go. So I-C-U, if I spelled it E-Y-E, then S-E-A, then E-W-E, I-C-U. But it would look like gibberish. But it would sound fine, and you'll see it here.
A hymn to heteronyms.
Please come through the entrance of this little poem. We guarantee it will entrance you. The content will certainly make you content, and the knowledge gained sure will enhance you. Heteronym, heteronym, look-alike words are a heteronym. Heteronym, heteronym, don't object to the object of the heteronym. A boy moped around when his parents refused for him a new moped to buy. The incense he burned did incense in the goat on a tear with a tear in his eye. He ragged on his parents, felt they ran him ragged, his just desserts they never gave. He imagined them out on some desert so dry where for water they'd search and they'd brave. At present he just won't present or converse on the converse of each high-flown theory. Of circles and axes in math class he has many axes to grind, isn't cheery. Heteronym, heteronym, look-alike words are a heteronym. Heteronym, heteronym, don't object to the object of the heteronym. He tried to play baseball but often skied out, so when the snows came he just skied. But then he broke his leg putting on his ski boot, and his putting in golf was in need. He once held the lead in a cross-country race till his leg started feeling like lead. But when the pain, he looked kind of peaked, his liver felt liver than dead. A number of times he felt number, all wound up like one with a wound, not a wand. His new TV console just couldn't consult or slough off a slough of the spawn. Heteronym, heteronym, look-alike words are a heteronym. Heteronym, heteronym, don't object to the object of the heteronym. The rugged boy paced round his shaggy rug room, and he spent the whole evening till dawn. Evening out the cross winds of his hate, now my anecdote winds on and on. He thought, does the prancing of so many does explain why down dove the white dove? Or why pussy cat has a pussy old sore and bass sing in bass notes of their love? Heteronym, heteronym, look alike words are a heteronym. Heteronym, heteronym, don't object to the object of the heteronym.
So you see all those rare words that look alike but are different in sound, meaning, and there they are. Good way to learn what a heteronym is.
And that's from a man of good words there. And Mr. Dr. Lederer of good words, have you got any new words or new information on words?
Well, my pleasure. You know, I'm 83 and a half now, and I have lived, and you guys out there could do the math, more than one third the number of years that America has officially been a nation. Do the math, and you'll see I have lived a scooch more than one third. And incredibly, I have 5 new books out, as well as this CD, shared, of course, in the last 2 years. My Halloween and Christmas books, and Still Time for Christmas. And then these are my Bouncing Baby Twin Etymology books. Who isn't interested in the origin of words and phrases? And trust me, because you know me, most of you, in a way that you have never seen done with etymology, the origin of words and phrases. They're all by thematic cluster. So you read a swatch and then you're done with that. So just for example, on the first one, upper left, funny bone, that's from body parts. The salamander, gerrymander, politics at the bottom, eponyms, that's the silhouette, and then Greek and Roman mythology with Zeus and Echo there. And you see the same with the second book. So, and verbivore.com, they're all up there. And Bill kindly put my email there, richardhlederer@gmail.com. And if you have any questions about
them, we can order them by emailing you or going to Verbivore.
Or PayPal. Right. Any of them. And I'm pretty well stocked with all of them.
Awesome. I have one question.
But the CDs, they order from you, not from
me. CDs from me on BillShipper.com. Just a question is, what's the etymology of I had it all ready to go. Okay, ready? 1, 2, 3. What's the etymology of edamame?
I have no idea. That would have been
on the song.
But I do not know. But I can tell you an etymologist is one who knows the difference between etymology and entomology. Mm-hmm. And don't bug me about that, although in our next song, we're going to have some entomology.
We are. And the next song is on you. It's your turn again here.
It sure is.
This week, you're going to do this from Acapulco?
I am. Well, I'm going to do it Acapulco, which would be a malapropism. And that's an example of someone's name, in this case, fictional, who becomes a word. And of course, that's going to be in the books. So, a spoonerism is a inadvertent, or then it becomes advertent, switching of initial syllables. And it comes eponymously, and don't go eponymous bosh on me, from a fellow named William Archibald Spooner, who entered the earthly stage in 1834, and who for 60 years was a distinguished, not extinguished, we're not going to get malapropistic here, but a distinguished professor of literature, history, and philosophy, and literature, but to his undying chagrin, was best known for his hilarious tips of the slung, or slips of the tongue. Meaning, what I've done there is reversed initial consonants and consonant blends. Slips of the tongue, tips of the slung, and the SL moves to the back, and the T from tongue moves to the front. So, for example, he is said to have said, and I think this is authentic, raised his tankard of ale to Queen Victoria, the reigning monarch, and intoned 3 cheers for our queer old dean. Now, all of you out there know he meant dear old queen, and there's the reversal. And you, as human beings, are wired to get it right. You know what it should be. Another time, he was a devout Anglican, and he entered church, and there was a woman sitting in his usual spot in that church. He approached her and said, "Maudon me, Padam, you are occupying my pie. May I show you to another? Sew you to another sheet." You see how the S and the SH go. So on the track, Bill is actually playing spoons, clickety clack, but we can't do it here for reasons we've explained. And we don't want to be out of the kitchen sink, right, Bill? So I'm going to gag you with a spoonerism and do this myself. This is Dr. Spooner's Animal Act. And again, picture the clickety-click in the background. Welcome, ladies. Welcome, gents. Here's an act that's so intense, that's two words, an absolute surefire parade, positive pure fire charade, that was a triple spoonerism, with animals weak and animals mild, creatures meek and creatures wild, with animals all in a row, I hope that you enjoyed the show. And we'll move on, Bill, to the next stanza. Bill, are you advancing with words here? Okay.
I am advancing with
words. Oh, yeah, there we go. There we go. Now, this is going to have a lot of entomology because, well, you'll see. Gallops forth a curried horse, trotting through a hurried course. Watch now how this speeding rider holds aloft a reading spider. Oh, God. Followed by a dragonfly as it drains its flagon dry. Step right up, see this mere bug drain the drink from his mere bug, beer mug. I just thinking how much I enjoyed writing this. Don't mess it up, Richard. Next
thing. It is tougher than it looks, folks.
Yeah, well, it shouldn't be. I wrote this a while ago. Now, this is all rabbits and bunnies. A wordplay boy bunny here. See a clever heeding rabbit who's acquired a reading habit, sitting on his money bags, reading many bunny mags, which tickle hard his funny bone as he talks on his bunny phone. He is such a funny beast, gobbling down his bunny feast. So that was all rabbits and bunnies. Sorry. I'll take a drink after. Lumbers forth a honey bear, fur as soft as bunny hair, gazed upon that churning bear, standing on a burning chair. Don't vacillate an ocelot, will oscillate a vassalot, vasalot, and a gift from our dame luck, there waddles in a large lame duck. That's Dr. Spooner's circus show with animals all in a row. As you can see, sorry, darn it, I give free rein to this metrical refrain. Now hops a dilly of a frog, followed by a frilly dog. Hear that hoppy frog advise. Time's fun when you're having flies.
Awesome. Take a drink, Rich. I think I need a drink too.
Yeah.
That it sounds great on the track, by the way, with the spoons,
yes,
there and the rhythm that keeps going.
H-I-J-K-L-M-N-O, that's H2O, my friends.
H2O. And where are we going next? Where are we going? Let's see.
I'll check.
We're
it.
Going back to the chat because we had a little action here. We've got a comment on.
Ooh,
first
I
of all,
it.
Mike, on the etymology, Mike's asking about the chapter on eponyms about me. And all right, for some reason, I'm missing that one, that reference there. So I want Mike to explain. My comment
yes,
didn't
Mike.
Get back to Facebook.
Mike, eponyms yeah. about me. Epo upon nim, word or name. So upon a name. As in guillotine and gerrymander and all of those, and malapropism.
Yeah, I was thinking about producing or releasing an eponymous CD, but I wasn't sure what to call it.
Eponymous Bosch.
That's a good idea. Yeah, eponymous, yes. Or maybe the Shakespearean curse, the curse about glue, you know, epox upon your house. Okay. I was thinking I'm dying to do a posthumous CD, but not quite yet. I'm not ready for that. So, but we got a question here from Barefoot Logic. What happens when a heteronym meets his doppelganger?
Oh, boy. Well, of course, a heteronym is in itself a kind of a doppelganger. I can't think of an answer. How about you, Bill?
No, you got me. So you're going to have to come up, Barefoot Logic,
oh,
and tell us.
No, I think I'm going to steal this one. Barefoot, what's the answer?
We'll give him a second to answer right
there. Or he can type it in, maybe.
Yeah, he can type it in. We do have a delay between about 20 seconds delay, I think, before it hits the feed. So that's chat's not going to always come back right away. But in the meantime, Can I sing you a song here, folks? And now if I were doing this live, everybody would say, yeah, sing a song.
Hey, Bill, gotcha. It's not just, you know, you can sing us a song, but it's may I sing you a song? It's not just ability, it's permission. Come on, get it right, man.
All right. And Mike's saying eponyms are self-titled things. There we go. He got it right. Barefoot Logic just got us. So I'm a folk singer, and I sing the songs of the people. And I sing what people, the way people speak. So I don't need to speak no good English there. I don't need to speak no proper stuff. I ain't going to do that.
Okay, I get it, right. And this irregardless, I'll go along with you.
All right, you go along with me. Because Bob Dylan didn't sing, he's saying, it ain't me, babe, right? The Rolling Stones wouldn't have gone anywhere with, I'm not able to achieve satisfaction.
Yeah, it ain't me, babe. I like it. It's not I, babe. You heard about the St. Peter hears the knocking at the gates of heaven, calls out, who's there? A voice says, it is I. St. Peter says, oh, goody, another English teacher. Come right in. So that's the cloth from which I am cut. I didn't end with a preposition. Hey, Bill, I love this song. Go ahead.
All right, here. We're going to do a little. If I remember how to remember the changes here. There's no lyrics to throw up there, but I think you all get this. Go away from my English class, I prithee take your leave. You've failed to grasp the concepts, and your writing makes me grieve. You need someone to defend you when your grammar is all wrong. But you've butchered all your syntax, and your clauses are too long. You need some serious writing critique. But it is not I, babe. Oh, no, it is not I, babe. It is not I whom you seek. Don't leave your comments on my blog. I'm not the person you suppose. I'll only parse your sentences and analyze your prose. Your apostrophes are catastrophes. You're a slave to passive voice. You dangle modifiers. Is it ignorance or choice? You need someone to help you write your book. But it is not I, babe. Oh, no, it is not I, babe. It is not I for whom you look, babe.
Marvelous. So, you know that one of the popular Rodgers and Hammerstein musicals is making a comeback in many communities. But they're calling it now Me and the King because they're bowing to the current grammar. Hey, what's that picture up there? It looks like a CD, Bill.
It looks like a CD, and just a reminder that the CD is available on BillShipper.com. And here's the other special I was telling you about to get your full collection of the Bill Shipper CDs. It is normally $65, which cost you with all this, but tonight through Sunday, we'll have it for $39.95 and send you free shipping just under $40, and you'll get all four of the Bill Shipper CDs, free autographs, and we'll send those to you. If you don't want just dances with words, just as $20 on BillShipper.com, and we appreciate your support because it makes all this possible. It helps us to put it together and to send it off to you. So that's my promotion for the night for now. And there's just a reminder there how it doesn't look Rich look great in that hat there. That's still becoming
Surely you jest.
No, my name's not Shirley. Yes. Don't call me Shirley.
And don't All right. call me late for dinner.
Yes. So full deck.
That's one of the 300 plus Greek figures of rhetoric that I've collected. But there we go. Full deckisms, and you know, you're not playing with a full deck. You've heard that, and it's become a marvelous game. And I've collected a whole bunch under certain categories, and Bill has woven them into a song that you're going to hear now. And you will hear, you know, food metaphors, computer metaphors, and all of that. This is one of our more recent songs that we've put on the track.
All right, and you're just one step ahead of me. I'm almost there in this quick changeroo. Boy, it's fun. You can do so much, but...
Not playing with a full deck and then not the brightest bulb in the Christmas tree and all of them. Her dipstick is a quart low, and there we go.
Here we go. Thank you for filling in there. One, two, and we'll get to the comments after this one there because we got some catching up to do on that.
I know a guy who's quite a joker, knows nothing about high-stakes poker, lost a shirt on a bad bet. He's not playing with a full deck. He's not playing with a full deck. A sandwich short of a picnic, two cans less than a six-pack. He's not playing with a full deck. He's a bubble of plum, one brick short of a full load. Lights on, but nobody home. That driveway don't reach the road. Somebody blew out his pilot light, a dim bulb in the marquee of life, sharp as a bag of wet mice. He takes an hour to cook minute rice. All foam and no beer, all lime and salt but no tequila. His brain is stuck in first gear, personality of an engineer. He's a legend in his own mind, not ready for prime time. A penny short of a paradigm, that bailer's done a run out of twine. He's not playing with a full deck, a sandwich short of a picnic, two cans less than a six pack. He's not playing with a full deck.
She's running on empty, slow as molasses in January, not the brightest bulb in the Christmas tree, one day past her warranty.
Sorry about that, folks.
He's as useful as a brick life vest, rode hard and put up wet. His learning curve looks like Mount Everest. He got a perfect 100 on his IQ test.
Her dipstick is a quart low, got an ego like a black hole, useful as a submarine with a screen door. Her brain's on crew control.
She's not playing with a full deck, a sandwich short of a picnic, two cans less than a six pack. She's not playing with a full deck.
As sharp as a mashed potato sandwich, all the notes but none of the music. A vacuum tube brain in a world of microchips. Her blender doesn't go past mix. All hat and no cattle, all horse and no saddle. That cornbread ain't done in the middle, up the creek without a paddle.
Not the sharpest tool in the shed, somebody stepped on his flower bed. His brain's an unfurnished room for rent, wheels spinning but the hamster's dead. He's not playing with the full deck, a sandwich short of a picnic, two cans less than a six pack. He's not playing with the full deck. He's not playing with the full deck. A sandwich short of a picnic, two cans less than a six pack. He's not playing with a full deck.
Boy, I love that one. I just love that song. The melody and the playfulness. You know, we live in a culture in which a playful tongue is not an idle tongue. It's not a sinful tongue. And that really helps.
That's one of our favorite there for sure. I think one of the audience favorite too. I play that out even locally and just everywhere. It's not too complicated in the language, just a fun song to do. Hey, we got to catch up.
People love joining in with the chorus.
I heard them all singing at home. I could tell.
Yeah, right.
Yes.
As I say, I have Van Gogh's ear for music. So we're all moving on the verbs, or you got something you need to say, partner?
We got to catch up on these chats here.
Oh, yeah.
First of all, the most important chat that we've got to catch up on is that Beth loves our bow ties. Bow ties are cool. Let's hear it for bow ties. Woo!
Well, I have to tell you about my bow tie. I get these from an outfit in Vermont called Bow Ties, capital B-E-A-U, space, capital T-I-E-S. Now, the homophonic pun is obvious. Bow, meaning this shape that's here, and Bill around his neck. We're both necrophiliacs. And then, of course, we both happen to be afflicted with XY chromosomes. So we're men. But the other that isn't as obvious is capital B-E-A-U space capital T-I-E-S. Put them together, beauties. That's called uncharading a word. And so I said I had to buy, and I've been very pleased with their products. Plus, it's harder to spill food on them, Bill, when you're eating, as you know.
Yes, yes, much better for that one. Okay, catching up on the captions on the chats. Remember a while back, Barefooter Logic says, what happens when a heteronym meets his doppelganger? And I think he must be typing with Pixon or something like that. All right, he finally comes up with an answer. Okay, he likes the song. Barefoot Logic, he or she, likes the song, likes the full deck, but he's a novice. They're a novice, and we haven't got the answer yet. So.
A novice has no vice. Notice, just no vice down the middle. And interested in any of that stuff, email me. Just be a little specific about at richardhlederer@gmail.com. Put the H in, and you'll get it within. I have a big gig tomorrow, a huge gig, but you'll certainly get it over the weekend.
Big gig. Like that. And Ken's asking about why is a raven like a writing desk?
Boy, that sounds Lewis Carroll to me, and I can't remember the answer.
Not Edgar Allan Poe type?
No, I think not. Well, never more that. But Kenneth, I think that is from Through the Looking Glass, maybe, and which, by the way, sesquicentennial at the very end of this year, 150th year. But I think that's Lewis Carroll. Now, what's the, you know, I'm not kidding. A crow has 16 bones in its wing, and a raven has 17.
Yes.
Okay. So the difference is a matter of opinion.
I heard that one.
Not much of a stretch there, William, you know, come on.
Pretty good. It fit it right in there.
It happens to be in the bird section of my etymology book, one of them. The
awesome.
First book, actually, yeah.
All right. So one more here. It's going to take a little longer. One of the reasons, Minnesota Mike here says he's sorry for the comments. He's nerding out, but that's why we love Minnesota Mike on these shows, because he nerds out.
Talk nerdy to me, please.
Yes. He says, is this example of a spoonerism, or is it something else?
Okay, go ahead. What
Gandhi's,
is it? I don't see it.
I'll read it. Gandhi King barefoot. He has profound visions.
Uh-huh.
He's skinny. And he has bad breath because of all his fasting, making him a super calloused, fragile,
super
mystic.
Fragile mystic, hexed by halitosis. That is the greatest syllable by syllable pun, and you wrote it well. Super callous, fragilistic, hexed by halitosis. Those are sound alike puns, but not spoonerisms, because you're not reversing initial syllables, but it's very closely related. And we, of course, when we hear that, we know it's supercalifragilisticexpialidocious, which happens actually to have a meaning, and is, by the way, was not in the Travers book. It was in the movie. I think she objected to it too, but it got in.
Yeah. She objected to a lot of things, I think, if you saw the movie about her.
Yes, I loved it.
All right, so things are getting tense again.
Yeah, and sure is.
Here's another song that's made out of Rich's verse. You want to tell us about this poem?
I sure will. Yes, so this is about the collision. I suspect that most of you are aware of the fact that broadly we have two different kinds of verbs. The one we're most used to is going from present to past to what we call present perfect is a verb like walk. So today I walk yesterday I walked, you hear a to there, I have often walked, and that's what we're used to. I have, and that, by the way, that is what we call present perfect. I have often walked on this street before, etc., etc. We're used to those. Then we have another kind, what are called Germanic ablautschrift, where the first are weak regular. They're regular because there are only three ways to do them. But they are weak because they need a suffix to go back in time. Now, on the other hand, we have ring, rang, rung. Those are called strong irregular. Strong because they don't need a suffix. They go back in time with the vowels in the middle, ring, rang, rung. And notice ring is dental up here, rang goes back there, and rung starts to go into the throat. As we go back in time, we go back in our own laryngeal anatomy. Interesting. And then there are hybrids like write, wrote, written. What is happening is we're losing strong, and I say irregular because there, I have identified 17 ways to make those verbs, as in write, wrote, written. We're losing those. So today you pleaded guilty, not pled guilty. Things like that. Probably you weaved through traffic rather than wove, although either is correct. You dived rather than dove. And of course, the big collision is lay, to put something down, as this pen. I am laying it down. Lay, past tense laid, present perfect. I have laid the pen on my desk. And that's standard. But it collides with lie, past tense lay, and then present perfect lane. Is that a word? Yes, L-A-I-N. It is a word. The dictionary has lain on the lectern for many years. So they are in collision, and we're losing the ones I like best, and that is the ring, rang, rung. So this is a, and let me see here. We're playing the track, I think, are we?
Or no,
are
you, I'm going to sing it. I'm going to sing
good,
it.
That's even better. So this is my lyrics and Bill's melody, and these lyrics are in the brand new Word Museum, opened up in, I think, December or January, in Washington, D.C.,
a Planet music, Word.
The Word Museum. Yep. So give us a verbal try here. Go ahead.
All right. Here we go. The verbs in English give me fright. Why can't I learn to read and write? Am I so stupid, thick or dense? Why can't I get past tense? Today we speak, but first we spoke. Some faucets leak, but never loke. Today we write, but first we wrote. We bite our tongues, but never bote. Then each day I teach, for years. Each day I teach, for years I've taught. And preachers preach, but never prot. This tale I tell, this tale I told. I smell the flowers, but never smold. And if knights still slay as once they slew, then do we play as once we blew? If I still do as once I did, then do cows moo as they once mid? Love to win games I've won. I seldom sin and never sun. I hate to lose and games I've lost. I didn't choose and never chost. I love to sing and songs I sang. I fling a ball but never flang. There's a strike that ball, the ball I struck. The poem I like but never luck. I take a break I took. I bake a cake, but never book. I eat that cake I ate. I beat an egg, but never bait. I often swim as I once swam. I skim some milk, but never scam. I fly a kite that I once flew. I tie a knot, but never two. I see the truth I saw. I flee from falsehood, never flaw. I stand for truth as I once stood. I land a fish, but never lured. About these verbs, I sit and think. The verbs don't fit. They seem to wink at me, who sat for years and thought of verbs that never fat or what. The verbs in English give me fright. Why can't I learn to read and write? Am I so stupid, thick or dense? Why can't I get past tense? Why can't I get past tense? Thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you to you, Fritsch, for that wonderful, wonderful verse that you've given us. Oh, let's have some more chats here. We have a couple messages coming through. Yeah.
Please.
Oh, Mike is asking, what's the correct past tense of the form of forego? I know the participle. This makes me overthink.
Interesting. I would say forewent. Now, there's a foregone conclusion invented by William Shakespeare, but that's not the past tense. I forewent it. How else would you say it? I foregoed it. I forewent it. So that would be the answer, but that's a tough one.
Mm.
And what is happening with lie and lay is we're losing lie. And it's, you know, I laid out in the sun all day. Well, no comment, but at any rate, it should be I lay out in the sun. And the problem is that the past tense of lie is lay, and that collides with the present tense of lay. Now, it may be 25 years from now. Hey, Richard, the only use of lie will be to tell an untruth. That may be. But for now, standard speakers and writers still make that distinction. And so you are advised to adhere to it. And if you'd like a longer disquisition on lie and lay, one of my books is titled, Sleeping Dogs Don't Lay. And you'll see the whole list on my website, verbivore.com. For now, it is a distinction we make.
Yes. So I finally put your picture back up there. And as while you're talking, I'm not always on the top of it for moving the screens, but we're getting there.
You're juggling a lot of balls and playing, and your plate is very full, Bill, and you just do amazingly. So shall we move on to another farewell?
Right. I just wanted to say we just have a few more things left, a couple more things to sing for you. But do keep sending your chats and questions, because we'll be here and talking all night if you let us. I might sleep in the corner here. But yeah, so now let's go on. And Rich, you're going to sing this one. Again, in the chapel, a cappella.
Right. So let's get the words up and give me the key. Okay. Are you putting the words up, Bill?
Yep. Yeah. It should be.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. You got them. Okay. So what happened is this is a poem I wrote for a book called The Word Circus. And it had a circus theme. It has a circus theme. And Bill has often, with this CD and the others, has set my words to music. And this one came in, and I will admit this, I just burst into tears. I said, that is the perfect, perfect melody. And it was just that 1 + 1 = infinity. And you all know that the circus is essentially closed down, you know, 5 whatever years ago, particularly Ringling Brothers, Barnum and Bailey. and I miss it. And I understand there are very cogent concerns about the treatment of the animals, but I did write this poem, and Bill has set it to music. And on the on the track, it is also a beautiful piano brings it along. So, Bill, if you could put the words up. Right. I mean, I can do it from my notebook, but if you can put
I'll go back now. Okay, I'll go back.
There we go. So give me a key. Of course, again, as I say, Van Gogh's music. But all of Solomon's processions and Croesus gold and Trump's possessions cannot rival half the pomp of animals that march and romp. Yeah. Thank you. What soul among us does not thrill to a fiery hoop and a lion's skill, the chittering of a monkey's laugh, the mottled grace of a slim giraffe? Who can be deaf to the ponderous sound of pachyderms that shake the ground? Leathery monarchs lifting high their trumpet trunks to canvas sky. And who is so proud as not to feel a secret all before a seal that keeps such slick and moist repose, spinning a ball upon its nose? And who can forget a mighty horse capering through its circle course? Who is so old who fails to heed a lady in pink on a milk-white steed? And now there's an interval of, I guess, the piano playing, but we don't have that here. And then after a pregnant pause, nothing now to mark the spot but a littered vacant lot, sawdust in a heap, and where the center ring stood grass-worn bare. But remain the sounds and sights, the artists, music, beasts, and lights. May the spangled memory soar in our hearts forevermore.
Awesome, awesome.
Awesome is true, and thanks to your melody, my man.
Thank you, Rich. And that is a beautiful piano on there. I was able to hire a young man in the Memphis, talented Memphis musician, who put a wonderful, wonderful track on that to give that feeling there. And okay, I want to play one last song for you here. You talked earlier, Rich, about the number of instruments, and I just actually did add it up there. I think with the slide whistle, we have eight instruments, and we actually have an additional one. We have just a mouth whistle on this one, on the Limericks song, and I had wanted to put it in there, and the engineer said, well, I learned how to whistle. My father was a good whistle. He told me how. So, yeah, we actually used his whistle because it was much better than mine. And
don't you think that Whistler's mother would have been better than the father?
Well, his mother wasn't available at that time.
And, yes. So Limericks, Bill and I love them, and we have a little melody for them. You'll hear on the track. And the limerick is what we call a fixed form. That is, you get the vessel, and then you pour your words and thoughts and ideas and humor, in this case, into it. the limerick is clearly the most popular, and so popular because I know we have a number of mentions listening in. I ran a limericks contest on Christmas limericks, and I was just swamped in a very good way. And you mentions, when you get your November, December issue, which will be toward the end of November, you will see 6 pages full of your limericks there. They were just great fun. And so you're going to hear some of the famous limericks that Bill is going to play for us.
Yes, now that you mention it.
Yeah, that's right.
All right. All right.
That's how Bill and I met.
I should have been queuing up the right one while we're doing that. But, so some of these limericks are not yours. They're other writers. You want to mention that? And then three of them will be yours also, Richard.
Well, if you're still queuing, I'll try to write something that's better, or my name isn't Richard H. Lederer, my grammar's definitive. I'll unsplit your infinitive and undangle your participles, etc. So that's how the limerick works. Hey.
Here we go.
Dark limerick packs laughs anatomical into space that is quite economical. But the good ones I've seen so seldom are clean, and the clean ones so seldom are comical.
A wonderful bird is the pelican. His bill will hold more than his belly can.
There's
he
a
can take
whistle.
In his beak enough food for a week, but I'm damned if I see how the hell he can.
Now we got a trombone player again. He just slides right in there, you see.
The bustard's an exquisite fowl with minimal reason to growl. He escapes what would be illegitimacy by the grace of a fortunate vowel.
This is yours,
Richard. Dragon with fiery plume crashed a wedding and smashed up the room. Ate every hors d'oeuvre, crushed the cake, what a nerve! Then toasted the bride and the groom.
Here's the whistle.
Wow.
A ghost and a witch with a broom, and a ghoul and a bat in a room, stayed up very late so that they could debate about who should be frightened of whom.
The invisible man came to dine. He sat right to my left, which was fine. But his rumblings abdominal were simply phenomenal, and everyone thought they were mine.
My favorite. Awesome. That's one of my favorites on the track also. I hope you all enjoyed that. And you know what? We're coming. That was the last thing that we're going to actually play. We're going to sing one as we go out. But I wanted to remind you all about the books or the CDs, first of all. It's a CD release. So if you haven't got yours yet, go to billshipper.com and order it. You can go $40 for all the CDs together or $20 for the Dances with Words CD at billshipper.com. Don't forget to go to verbivore.com and get your copies of the two new books on etymology and or literary trivia. The other one, numbers 51, 52, 53, 54, 55, right?
Well, I think. Right. With the holiday books. That's correct. Right.
And then, so the holiday books, also, we've got this here. We just passed Halloween, but you can still pick it up, and it's time to order Christmas humor for Christmas. Don't forget to your Christmas gift list as you shop here. Get a couple extra copies of everything there, and we appreciate the support because it does keep us on the air, as it were, going on. All right.
Now, Bill, with this closing, I'm not sure I have notes. I have here that we both do our regular verses here separately.
Yes, we're going to do it separately because we can't be in the kitchen right. sink. Like you said, we'd be out of.
No, I agree. So in my notes, I go the first stanza, you go the second, and so on.
All right.
Am I correct?
Go ahead.
And who does the chorus then?
Whoever gets to it first.
All right. Well, okay, fine. Me, because I love this song. So give me a key there. Okay. No, that's right. You're not. Well, oh, am I singing to you or playing? Oh, just the key. So closing up a little form of the first, love seeing you. If I can be helpful in answering any of your questions, email me. I'm a teacher. I'm a compulsive sharer. RichardHLederer@gmail.com. And I've written at this stage on almost everything linguistic, Shakespeare authorship, lie versus lay. What's this about? They is the third person singular as well as plural. Is our civilization crumbling with that kind of thing? Email me and I will send you what you asked for unless I haven't written on it. So here we go. Give me a key, Bill. From Alpha to Omega, you can bet the alphabet, like a painting done by Degas, will leap and pirouette.
It's stupendous, tremendous, and over endless, dances with words.
We're dancing with words, prancing with words, enhancing, entrancing, advancing with words. It's dances with words.
Do the next.
I'm a verbivore and wordaholic, logoreic and eclectic. Lexically, I'm apoplectic, lavophile and logoleptic.
We're dancing with words, prancing with words, enhancing, entrancing, advancing with words. It's dances with words.
It's glorious, uproarious, I'm not going to get this. It's glorious, uproarious, notorious, victorious, outrageous, courageous, contagious, and verbivorous, dances with words. We love you all. Thank you so much.
All right. Thank you so much for tuning in. And we appreciate that. We're going off now. I don't see any more chats, so... Thank you again, and talk to you. Keep on the Bill Shipper list so you find out what's going on. Bye now, everybody. Bye-bye.